Hello. So just let me know, guys. We'll start in 1 minute. But just let me know if you can hear me well, so that I can start when we're ready. So it's all yeah. It's now. It's actually 4 o'clock, but we'll still wait at least 1 or 2 minutes for people to join. But I want to make sure that you can hear me well. Yeah, so maybe now I'm live, I'm not sure. Okay, I'll probably so you also probably didn't hear me too well. So perhaps you can hear me better now. Just let me know so that I can start. Okay, great. So I have some input, so I know that you're hearing me well and you can also see my screen. So today I'm going to discuss about recurrent neural networks in general, and we're also going to discuss about some specific architectures like long short-term memory networks with some small variations on top of the basic architecture, and also some applications on sequence to sequence modeling. So this is the topic for today, and the plan is first we will discuss about the models, the generic models. Then we will discuss about the training algorithm and the problems that can appear when we train recurrent neural networks, and some tips that are useful if you want to implement these models in practice. So useful tips about training. Yeah, and then we will discuss about LSTMs and neural machine translation, and we will see a specific LSTM architecture which is called sequence to sequence that can be used for this task. Okay, so this is a new topic for you. So recurrent neural networks are usually based on modeling sequences, and this can be modeled as well as for the input but also for the output. So we have different configurations that are possible, for example, one-to-one. So this means a standard architecture where we have one input and one output. So there is no sequence here, but we also have configurations like an input and we want to extract a sequence from this input, or we have a sequence and we want to extract a single output, and so on. So the idea of a recurrent neural network is that they are based on a recursive connection or recurrent connections. So we'll detail this in a few moments next, but yeah, in general, we deal with models that have feedback connections, not only forward connections. So it's not a classic feed-forward architecture. So we will discuss about two important types of recurrent neural networks: long short-term memory and gated recurrent units. The problem that we aim to address with recurrent models is that standard neural networks cannot model sequences. So usually when we apply a neural network, even if it is a convolutional or a more complex architecture, I don't know, with attention mechanism, it's still designed to take fixed sized input and to provide a fixed size output. So there is no temporal structure that we can model with a pure feed forward processing network. And also, let's say that, for example, we might try to model a temporal sequence. For example, I don't know, let's think of a video sequence. So, for example, we can apply a convolutional neural network on a frame-by-frame basis, to recognize actions in video. The problem is we will get better recognition if we can memorize, for example, the previous frames. So this way we'll know more information about the motion that is happening. So in a pure feed-forward algorithm, there is no memory of the previous inputs. So here in video, it's clear that this information is useful for the current frame. Okay, so this is the problem that we cannot model sequences, and there are many cases in which we need to model sequences in order to obtain good results. So, for example, if we want to recognize handwriting and to translate basically the handwritten words into digital text. So in this case, if you go with a standard model, you look at each letter. In some cases, you will not recognize the letter. And I will give you some example in one of the next slides, and you will see clearly that doing individual recognition on letters is not optimal. So this is one example. We also have an example with sound. So typically, voice is a sequence, is a temporal sequence that can be modeled to a recurrent neural network. So here we can use, for example, speech to text model based on a recurrent structure to obtain improved results. And another example is translation. So we have a sentence, and the sentence, of course, is a group of words that have a specific order and meaning. And then when we want to translate this sequence into a different language, of course, it is not so we do not translate word by word, because in a different language the words may appear in a different order, as in this example from German and English. We see that some of the words do not appear in the same order. Okay, and there are examples even when it's not very clear that we have a sentence. So for example, one of the state-of-the-art applications of recurrent neural networks is to do image captioning. So I think I showed you some examples in the first lecture, but here, I mean, the concrete architecture is based, okay, it has some convolutional structure to recognize pattern in images. But then to produce language, it needs to produce a sequence, so a sequence of words, then it will need a recurrent network to produce the output. And also, it is also applied, for example, in sentence parsing. So you can find a part of speech tags using a recurrent network. So this, if you think of this graph structure as a sequence, so essentially pass through the graph will result in a certain sequence. So yeah, this is a third example where we have, so this is from a paper, you have the link down here, in which they applied a recurrent network to generate images. So the way they designed the network is based on this observation that the visual cortex, when it reads, interprets the text as a sequence. So there were some theories, for example, that people read in parallel, but it seems that, so I mean, the characters, but actually it seems to be a sequential process. So they tried to model this this idea and to generate a recurrent neural network to generate images. So this is on the Google Street View house number dataset, and they show how this this network generates a sequence, and they obtain better results than the previous state of the art. Yeah, so another example is we can also use recurrent networks to obtain deeper and deeper representations of images. So for example, we have a network F, and we can apply it on as a recurrent network. So F composed with F, it means that here we apply F on top of the output of F, and actually here we also concatenate with the previous input. So if we use multi-resolution images and apply F multiple times, we can also obtain improved results compared to a standard architecture. So there are many, many examples where we can use sequences. So as I told you before, it is important to model model problems using sequences. So this is an example with handwritings, and here you have two letters which are not so easy to identify. So they even look very similar to each other. So okay, you might think of what these letters are. You can try to make some guesses, but you will probably not get it right unless you see the whole word. So when you look at the word that is written, so it's a an English word, brace, then you can easily figure out that this is an R and this is a C. While when you see just the individual letters, it's clear you can confuse them with something else. Okay, so modeling sequences is important because the context, the temporal sequence, gives us context about the current input and output, and can improve the results of the system. So this additional information that comes from, I don't know, the previous text or the following text, the succeeding text, is a useful information. And yeah, this is another example here with the word defense, and if we just look at individual letters of the letter N, it's hard to figure out that's a letter, but if you read the entire word, you can figure it out. Okay, so first idea to model this to model this problem. So we are trying to slowly build this idea of a recurrent network. So yeah, without recurrence, the first model, just based on the history of the previous letters, could be this could be modeled with the hidden Markov models. So I'm not sure if you discussed about these models in I know we didn't discuss it at our practical machine learning lectures. I'm not sure, maybe you discussed them and probabilistic programming or not, but anyway, so in hidden Markov models, you consider the probabilities of the, I don't know, for the current prediction, given the previous letters that appear in the word. So for example, if you have the letters BR, and here you have, I don't know, some options like A or O or something, then you will have some probabilities that can be computed on some sample handwritten text documents, and based on these probabilities you can choose the letter with the highest probability in the current context. So this is the main idea. So yeah, the essentially we apply some in general here, so we just use this probability, but in general we have some history and some function f, and we determine the current state of the model. So based on the previous state at time t minus 1, we apply the function and we obtain the current state. So Essentially, we just take the previous state into account. And actually, we do not model only the state, but we also have some input at every moment in time. So this is a more more close model that is related to machine learning. So we have some input x at each moment in time. So from the previous example, this could be, for example, a handwritten letter. And we have the current state that models the history, let's say, of previous letters. And then we have a function that estimates the next letter and so on. So yeah, we represent this structure like this, but this can go for an infinite number of times. So in we can also represent this model like this. So here we can see that actually we have the same function here, f, with the parameters theta. So this function is applied recursively over the input and the state, the current state s. So actually the output state goes back into the input of the network along with the current input x. So yeah, this type of architecture has this type of connection is called a feedback connection. So this gives, or recursive connection, and this gives the name of this type of neural networks. Okay, so yeah, in this example we also have the corresponding output. So for each input we can also have an output. So this is, I think, maybe the most generic formulation. So we have an input at every moment in time and the output for every moment in time. But as I said in the first slide, we can also have different relations. So we have a sequence and we want only a single value as output, and so on. So yeah, the architecture is represented like this, as a recurrent infinite structure. But we can also unfold this architecture into the steps, and we represent it like this. So actually, in order to train this kind of neural networks, we need to unfold the model and to represent it like this in order to be able to train such models. So unfolding the architecture is one of the key aspects that that are done in practice to train such models. Okay, so in addition to having some input here and some weights, so we can also add weights between I don't know, the input layer and the hidden layers, and also weights from the hidden layers to the output layers. So one way to represent the networks is also like this. So this is an unfolded structure, and if we have I don't know, the typical representation, we add these connections between units from the same layer with feedback connections. Okay, so this is some generic representation, and of course this covers a different a broad range of models, as I said before. So concrete examples. So for example, if we have one input with one output, it means that here we do not have any temporal sequence for input or output. So this is, I don't know, standard classification and regression problems. So of course, we can also apply recurrent neural networks for these kind of problems. It might not be the optimal approach, but it will definitely give some results. I'm not sure, it might be comparable with convolutional neural networks in some cases, and so on. Then we have, for example, one-to-many, where we want to do image captioning. So here we have a single input, an image, and as output we want the sequence. So this is a one-to-many architecture. Then we also have many-to-one. So for example, we have an input sentence, or an input text, and we want a single output, for example, to classify the sentence, I don't know, into positive or negative opinion, and so on. Then we also have the example with many to many. And here we have two different examples. So this type of architecture that is shown here is actually a sequence to sequence architecture, and we're going to discuss it in more detail next. So it's used for a neural machine translation, but it was also applied for other types of data. Okay, so the problem with the recurrent neural networks is that if you want to train such models, things can get arbitrarily complex. So in order to avoid this, we use unrolling. So the first ideas are that we have parameter sharing. So the same parameters are passed from one iteration to another, and in the same time this is done in while we unroll the algorithm. Okay, so this doesn't so unrolling doesn't grow the number of parameters, and yeah, we this also allows arbitrary sequence length, so we can have sequences of any length, in theory at least. In practice, we will see that for some type of architectures are not cannot model very long time sequences. Okay, so we also discuss about the depth of the network. So the depth is measured in the usual sense as the number of layers, not in terms of the number of unrolling steps. And yeah, the thing is, when we unroll the algorithm, we have to decide on the number of steps, and still we can have problems with learning even with shallow models. So here shallow means we don't have so many layers, but even with a single layer, the model is still very complex and hard to train. Okay, so yeah, next we will discuss about so we discussed about the generics, the about these models, recurrent neural networks. We will discuss a bit about the learning, and then we will see some concrete models and more details about the architecture. So yeah, in a generic recurrent neural network, we have the input at time t, we have some weight vector that is learned, and we have a hidden state that is also a vector, and we use the input x and the hidden state and these weights to generate some output. And then for example, suppose that we are at this time step t plus 1. So usually when we do backpropagation, we do it from input, so from the current input, sorry, from the current output to the current input. So in training recurrent neural networks, actually here when we do backpropagation, we also backpropagate to the weights, and these actually depend from the previous step. So then we have to do backpropagation to step t and backpropagation to step t minus 1 and so on. So in theory, this can go to an infinite number of steps. Of course, in practice, we cannot do this. So we have to fix a number of steps that we do backpropagation of the gradients. So this type of algorithm is called backpropagation through time. So the main steps are, so we have a sequence of time steps of input and output. We unroll the network architecture and calculate and accumulate the errors across each time step. And then we roll up the network and update the weights. So this is how the algorithm is typically implemented. Sorry, this is how the algorithm is implemented in theory, but in practice, in order to be able to train a recurrent network, we use a truncated backpropagation through time. So the sequence is processed one time step at a time, and periodically we do K1 time steps of BPTT, and then for a fixed number of time steps we perform the update backwards. This is the K1 is when we apply the algorithm, and K2 is how many steps from the current time step we go with the backpropagation. So yeah, when we use BBTT, we have these parameters that we have to set up, and there are also some difficulties. So these kind of networks are not so easy to train, and one of the difficulties was studied by Răzvan Pașcanu, who is now at Google in London. So he studied during his PhDs recurrent neural networks, and he found that the error surface of such models has high curvature walls, so it has these points where the loss has a very steep descent. So if you apply standard gradient descent in this case, so for example, we have this point here, and the standard gradient descent is illustrated with continuous lines. So if you reach this point here, which is close to the minimum, if you are too close to the wall and you take a step in this direction, actually this can throw you off of the minimum. So in order to solve this problem, we need to rescale the gradient in order to fix the problem. So the magnitude, so when we train with the gradient descent, we know that the steepness of the gradient is proportional to the update of the weights. So here we have a very steep gradient, so the update will be very high and can throw us off. Okay, so in order to solve this problem, they proposed two fixes. One is called norm clipping. So this is a pretty standard and simple idea. So yeah, if the norm of the gradients is higher than a certain threshold, then we update the gradients by multiplying with this threshold divided by the norm. So this is called norm clipping. Okay, so yeah, this is called this problem is called exploding gradient problem. So when the gradient increases significantly, then your model starts to behave very badly. And the second fix is to do smart initialization and use ReLUs in the recurrent neural network. So in a typical architecture, you would use a hyperbolic tangent transfer, and even the LSTMs have this transfer function. And if you replace it with ReLU, you can solve this problem. But it seems that an even better idea that was proposed in 2015 was to initialize to also take care of the good initialization. So their main idea was to initialize the recurrent weights to be the identity matrix, and the biases to be equal to zero. So this actually means that each new hidden state vector is obtained by simply copying the previous hidden state vector, so from time t minus one, and then adding the effect of the current inputs. Okay, so yeah, we also have I think I had some more comments about training, but this is more specific to long short-term memory networks. So we will discuss about long short-term memory networks, starting first with a representation of a basic recurrent neural network. So in a basic network, we have the current input, we have the hidden state vector. So these are concatenated and passed through a hyperbolic tangent activation. And here we also have some, usually we have some weights that we multiply these components, and then we have as output the current state vector. So this is also the output of this recurrent neural network cell, and this hidden state is also passed to the next cell. So the next cell is the same cell, but at the next moment in time. Okay, so yeah, we use these notations. So for pointwise operations, we use these pink circles. So this means vector transfer. So this vector xt goes here as input. Here we concatenate the hidden state and the input, and here we copy. So the hidden state t is distributed to the output and to the next. To the input of the next cell. Okay, so this is the notation that we use. So the problem with this type of architecture is that it is very hard to model correlations, long-term correlations, so or long-term dependencies. So for example, in neural machine translation, in some words that appear at the beginning of a sentence in one language can appear at the end of the sentence in the other language. And with a standard recurrent neural network, it is very hard to model this dependency, essentially because the hidden state is updated with each pass, with each new word. And this update can remove the information about these preliminary states from the hidden state, or to actually not to remove it completely, but to dim it down. Okay, so one solution to this problem is to use long short-term memory networks. Okay, so I'm also checking to see so if there are any questions so far. So good. So with with long short-term memory networks, we want to solve this question, sorry, to solve this problem by explicitly encoding the memory. So the LSTM cell looks something like this. Actually, I'm going to explain it on this slide better. So we have actually two kind of hidden states, if you like. So we have the hidden state H, but we also have this state vector C, which is called a memory. Okay, so we have the memory that gets updated at every timestamp. So here, the memory we can decide, for example, if we should continue to remember it or not. So we take the hidden state from the previous layer, and we apply a sigmoid gate on top of it. And actually, sorry, we apply the sigmoid gate on top of the hidden state and the current input. And here we also have some weights for this gate, which is denoted by FT. So F comes from the forget gate. So this gate actually models what part of the current memory state, or how much of this we should forget. Considering the current input and the hidden state from the previous layer, we have to decide if we want to remember the what's in our current memory state or not. So we multiply the memory state with this forget gate. And if we want to also, we want to update the memory cell with some information. So, and if we want to update it, what should we add to this gate? So this is modeled using what is called the input gate. So this is another component of the LSTM cell. So in the input gate, we also have a sigmoid transfer function here. We have some weights of the input gate, which are applied once again on the current input and the previous hidden state. And we have also some bias terms. So this is the input gate, and this gives some weights to the new memory state that we want to add to the previous memory state. So the forget gate and the input gate are kind of weights that control how much of the previous information we use, and here how much of the current information we want to add in. And the information that we add is, as in a classic recurrent neural network, we have the hyperbolic tangent activation, and we have some weights here denoted by WC, and these are once again applied on the previous hidden state and the current input XT. So this is the new state vector. So this gets multiplied with IT, and then this is added to the current memory. So when we combine these, actually the memory is updated with FT times the previous memory state plus the input gate times the new things that we want to memorize. Okay, so so far so good, and we also have the output gate. So here we have another set of parameters W, O and B O. O from the output. These are once again applied on the hidden state, on the previous hidden state and the input, and we have the output, which is. The output says, okay, well, what part of the current memory I want to give at output for this unit. So I have this memory state, for example, and I want to output some part of it, and I can identify it by learning these weights OT. So then I will multiply the current memory state with OT, and I will obtain the hidden state, which will be also the output of this LSTM cell. Okay, so using this memory, we can actually remember long-term dependencies, as well as short-term dependencies. So this gives the name of the model, which is called the long short-term memory network. Okay, so this is how one cell works. So as in classic recurrent neural networks, we have these cells that are unfolded from left to right, and this is an LSTM layer. Okay, so yeah, this is a very sophisticated cell, and there are also some variants proposed in literature of the LSTM that make it even more complex than this. So there is one type of LSTM called LSTM with peephole connection. So here we also have for these forget gates, input gate and output gates, we also have as input the current, sorry, for the forget and the input gate, we have the previous memory state, and for the output gate we have the current memory state as input. So these are all concatenated together, and this gives us the output. So remember that all these are vectors. So this is a vector, this is a vector, and this is also also a vector. Okay, so this is one type. Another type of LSTM has coupled gates. So yeah, of course. So for example, if you want to forget some part of the previous memory state and to add some part of the current to memorize part of the current input, we can also model this in a simple, more simple way. So we replace the forget gate and the input gate with a single gate. So here the part that we forget will be replaced with the part that we want to add in. So we memorize something new only if we forget something from the past. Okay, and I think one of the most popular variants of LSTM are gated recurrent units. So these are actually also seen as independent models, gated recurrent units. So this tries to keep some of the architecture of the LSTM, but actually while also removing the explicit memory. So here the memory is this type of architecture tries to save the this tries to memorize information about the previous states in the hidden state, so in the hidden output. So here HT also plays the role of memory, and we have a parameter ZT that models what part of it we want to memorize and what part we want to add. And we model this as in this type of LSTM with coupled gates. So this idea is also borrowed here for recurrent gated recurrent units. And another thing is that we also remove the memory from this type of cell. Yeah, so in practice, I don't know, you can try both of these models and see which one works better. It seems that the gated recurrent units are easier to train. So it's probably at least at the beginning is probably a better option. So another problem with training these models is the is caused by gradients with different magnitudes. So we note that the gradients do not give us the direction to optimum. They are just giving us the direction of the steepest ascent locally, right? So for example, if we have a function that has the minimum here, and actually from this point the gradient on it will point us to this direction. So in this direction we have a small descent, and on this axis we have a larger descent. So will point us in this direction, and here it will follow a zigzag pattern. This happens because the gradients on these two axes have mismatched magnitudes. So on one axis we have a large magnitude, so here we should actually travel with a small distance, and on the other axis we have a small magnitude, so there we can travel with a larger distance. Okay, so the intuition of this optimization rule, which is called root mean squared optimization, so RMS prop, is an update rule that is based on computing the mean square of the weights at time t. as the mean square from the previous timestamp plus so these are also some parameters that can be adjusted. So we consider the previous norm. So actually the mean square actually contains the magnitude of the vectors on each direction. So here we update the magnitude with the current magnitude from the current update. So then the gradients when we compute sorry yeah when we compute the gradient for the update rule, we will divide the actual gradient by this mean square, root mean square. So this is the root mean square error, and we also have here the learning rate. So when we divide the gradients like this, large gradients will be divided by a larger value. So then you will travel a smaller distance, while small gradients will be divided by a smaller value, so we'll travel a larger distance in that direction. So it seems that with this type of optimization, you can train recurrent networks. So a good choice for LSTMs and GRUs is to opt for this type of optimizer. Okay, so I think we have a question here. So maybe the question, I'm not sure, maybe it's related to LSTM. Okay, so let me check it again. So white uses two types of activations. You mean sigmoid and hyperbolic tangent, or and weights on the same input. And weights on the same input. Oh, so I'm not sure if I can understand the question completely. So is this like why does it uses two types of weights on the same input? So you mean maybe not two type of weights, but two different weights on the same input and output, and then do the product. What is the intuition? Okay, so yeah, I'm not sure if I explained. So essentially when I tried to explain it as best as I could. So here when we have the so this is a vector, right? So if you want to remove some part of the vector, you have to multiply it with a vector that has values between 0 and 1. So here the intuition, you want to use a sigmoid because the sigmoid gives you outputs between 0 and 1. Here you want to add in some information, but this is the input gate is also some weight computed for the things that you want to add in. So for example, you compute this current thing that you want to memorize, this vector C tilde, but then you also learn this part on how much of tilde you want to memorize. So here you also use a sigmoid gate. So this is these are like some sort of weights that are between 0 and 1. But here the memory can also have negative components. So the actually memory can also memorize negative values. So here you would use the hyperbolic tangent. And we also have the output here. And once again, here you want to learn some weights to compute for the current cell state CT, so that you can output something that is useful. So for example, here in the CT vector, you have some, let's say this is a sequence-to-sequence model. So you have the input of some word in some language, that is, let's say, embedded in a embedding space. So it's a vector. We try to memorize it in the cell state, but here we will probably not want to output the same vector. We want to output something from the cell state. But we will try to figure out the current word based on the previous the current input and the previous hidden state. So yeah, once again here we have a sigmoid to determine how much of this information we want to weight. And here we have, once again, this is a vector with, I don't know, positive and negative values. So here you want to use tan h and obtain a vector that is also has positive and negative values. Okay, so this is why we have different activation functions. So we have sigmoid and hyperbolic tangent. And for each of these weights, these are particular. So we cannot use the same weights everywhere. So for example, we want to forget something from the cell state vector. We want to learn through these weights to learn the right weights FT, so the right vector of weights. Then here we have a different vector of weights, and of course these can be different from the weights that we use in other places. So we naturally want to use different weights for each of these forget input and output gates. Okay. Okay, so I think, yeah, maybe I explained it better now, I hope. If you still have any questions, Mihai, just let me know. So yeah, I think I went to the slides pretty fast because I think I'm almost close to finishing, but okay, see another question here. Okay, so for the output we use HT. So the output is HT. So I'm not sure. Or you mean as input? So here, yeah. So the output, so the hidden state we use everywhere here, we use the hidden state from the previous layer. And the output, this is the output from the previous layer. The hidden state is also the output from the previous layer. And the current output, HT, is based on these weights of the output gate that are applied on the memory cell CT. So this gives us the hidden state for the current timestamp HT. So yeah, this output goes to the next cell, and this also is also the output of the current cell. So yeah, this goes as input, but it will go here as input to for the next time, for the next timestamp. Okay, so okay, it's good that we have these questions and we made things more clear. Okay, so now we'll discuss a bit about sequence-to-sequence learning. So one application, for example, is in speech recognition. So we have a sequence of spoken words, and we want to recognize the spoken words and to transform this into some form of digital text. Another application is in machine translation. So we have a sentence in some language, and we want to have the translation in a different language, and so on. So there are other applications. So for example, question answering. So we have a sequence of words that represents a question, and you want to produce a sequence of words that represent an answer for that question, and so on. So we will discuss, I think the first application of sequence to sequence was on machine translation. So we will discuss more about this task. And first we will present how the task was usually performed before neural machine translation. Okay, so in classical machine translation, we use a statistical approach. So mainly we have the sentence in let's say in Spanish. We have words that are translated or phrases that are translated, and then based on some statistical analysis, so we have some language model of English, let's say, that is learned on hundreds of thousands of documents, and then we know how good English sounds and how bad English sounds, and from these sentences we can select one that sounds English, so it has a higher probability of appearing in text than other sentences. Okay, so here there are two models that are used jointly. So we have a translation model that takes the words or phrases or multi-word expressions and translates them into the corresponding translations in a different language. And then we also have a language model, let's say in this case for English. And then we have a decoding algorithm that is based on probabilities of the input sentence E, and given the partial translation and the input, we have to decode the output sentence. Okay, so we have three components: a translation model, a language model, and the decoding part, the decoding algorithm. So for the translation model, here actually we want to learn the probability of a sentence F given the input sentence E in a different language. So the way this works is first we take the sentence and we divide it into phrases, or so this can be individual words or multi-word expressions or noun phrases or verb phrases and so on. So there are different approaches here. Okay, so we take these individual phrases that can be translated to the other language. Of course, here we lose the context, and in many cases we get different translations. So for example, there could be words that can have I don't know, different translations if they have synonyms, and we lose the context. Here we might get some wrong words. But anyway, this is the first step, so we assume we can translate these phrases well, and then we reorder the phrases in order to try to find the right order. So for this part, we use the language model. Here in the language model, we want to generate a sentence that has good English. So the standard technique here is to use a trigram model, but of course there are also models that based on longer n-grams and so on. It's actually a trade-off between the number of documents that you have for training and the number of sorry, and the length of n-grams that you can use. So typically you use 3 grams. So for each when you want to generate a word, you have to compute the probability of the current word based on the previous two words. And of course, for each word you have different options and you have different probabilities, and you apply the argmax on top of these probabilities to select the word with the best likelihood. So this is actually done in the decoding step. So here you put these translation models and language models to do the actual translation. So you have the individual models, and now for the decoding, when you generate the sentence, you apply these models jointly. So let's say we have this sentence. So we have also the phrase translation here, and then it's like going through a graph of possibilities. So we have the start of sentence, so this is a special token, and here we have some probabilities for starting the sentence. So we have the probability with Mary, probability with which is lower. So then we select Mary for the next word. So given the probability that, so given that we have the word Mary selected here, what is the probability of the next word being slap? And so on. So in the end, we get using this process, we get a translation of this sentence. So yeah, there are this graph can have many options to explore. So in general, we can prune out the weakest hypothesis. So we can, for example, keep all possibilities higher than a certain threshold, or keep the top, I don't know, 100, and so on. Okay, so this is the classical approach. So it's not the main idea that we want to use. It's just to point out how we this machine translation was done before neural machine translation, and also point out the weaknesses. So also the language model, of course, is trained on some data, and it's very easy to have bias in this data. So you really need a very large data sets with examples to have a good language model. And yeah, also the translation, since it's based on individual phrases, can already introduce some mistakes. So it doesn't really consider the entire context when a translation is made. Okay, so as an alternative to this mainstream approach, Sutskever in 2014 introduced the idea of sequence-to-sequence learning with neural networks. So this is commonly referred to as neural machine translation nowadays. So the model is we have an encoder network that models the input sequence. So this is a recurrent network, and also a decoder network that decodes from the input of the encoder, decodes a sequence that is the translation of the input sequence in a different language. So this is the generic architecture. Actually, the model is designed as a LSTM. So there are some units here, but actually the units are not identical. So we have some LSTM units, so an LSTM layer that has that doesn't output anything. So this layer only takes the input sentence and builds the hidden state. So actually it gives us an embedding of the sentence, and then when it reads the end of sentence token from the input, it goes the information goes through the decoder, which starts to decode the sentence and translate it. So here one important thing to mention is that when we train this type of architecture, I'm not sure if I mention it anywhere in the slides, but one important detail here is to improve performance by several percentages is to replace the output from the previous state with the actual output. So during training, you know what is the input sentence and what is the corresponding translation. So you know both of these components, right, during training. So then if your model starts to make predictions that are spurious or wrong, so for example here it will predict a word that is not correct, let's say, then if you give this word as input to the next cell state, then it will likely also produce another wrong output and so on. So in order to train this type of architecture, a trick that is done here is to replace the prediction in the next cell state with the actual correct input that you already have. So even if it starts to, or it makes a wrong translation, then here as input you will give the right word as input to the next cell state. So this trick helps to gain several percentage points in terms of accuracy from this model. Okay, so this is the main architecture. We have an encoder here and a decoder here. So in more detail, how does these components look? So the encoder and decoder look something like this. So we have an input sentence E. Let's say we have this sentence. And then the first thing that we do is we represent the words and some as I don't know, one of k coding. So this can be, for example, a bag of words representation. So we have the vocabulary of words, and for each word we model it as a one hot vector with using one for the corresponding position in the vocabulary. Okay, so this will be the input. Then from this one of k coding, which is very sparse and high dimensional, we will build, we have an embedding layer which embeds, which generates a more compact representation of this word embedding. So here we have a shorter, a denser representation of the same words. And these short representations are given as input to the cells. So here we have also the hidden states that are passed from one cell to the other. So then when the sentence is finished, the last hidden state models the entire sentence here. And then after we have the entire sentence, then we start the decoding. So here we also have a hidden state. So this is a different layer with a hidden state, which tries to decode the from this current state. It tries to decode some word probabilities, and then from these probabilities we apply some argmax automatically, and we obtain a word sample. So this is given as input to the next cell state, but as I said before, we can replace it with the correct prediction here in order to make sure that the decoder doesn't deviate too much from the correct output. Okay, so yeah, one problem with this model. So it actually it has a small problem, but I think it's the right way to do it is like this. Or at least we'll see that there are some possible improvements. But the main idea, so why the model works like this, is that, for example, we start here, I don't know, so the first word in this sentence here can be the last word in the translation, depending on the language, right? So we cannot start the translation before seeing the entire sentence. So perhaps we will also want to start the translation with the last word. So then we have to wait to see all the words in order to produce a good and correct translation. So this is why we have first to encode this entire sentence and then decode it after we have all the sentences encoded in our hidden state. Well, the problem is if we have long-term dependencies and the sentences are very long, In the hidden state, the first words here will not be very well represented in a hidden state, and we will not get a good translation out of this model. Okay, so this is a look, a more detailed look into the encoder. So once again, we have this one of K coding representations, sort of bag of words. Then we have the continuous space dense representation of the vectors that are learned, and then we have the we have the hidden state. So these are recurrently learned from one step to another, and then for the decoder, first we take the hidden state. We produce the word probabilities, the output, the word probabilities, the output, and then we repeat this process until we translate the entire sentence. Okay, so essentially, the problem with this type of model is in the learning. For very long sentences, it might have problems with vanishing gradients. So essentially, for the state HT, when you do backpropagation, sorry, from the cell, for the current cell state CT, you compute the gradients with respect to the hidden state, and these backpropagate through the weights, but this also backpropagates. So this is for the current step, and from the previous step you also do backpropagation to the previous hidden state, and here you also have the gradients from the previous state. So these are also backpropagate to the weights and to the previous cell, and so on. So if this can also lead to vanishing gradients problem, and this actually affects the LSTM model. So another problem is the exploding gradient problem. So essentially, these two problems together can affect the model. So as I explained earlier, for the LSTM model, for sequence to sequence translation, they use the scale gradient. They scale the gradient using the root mean square prop optimizer. Okay, and another idea that they used to improve the model was also to perform the translation from the last word to the previous word. So from backwards actually. So you can input this sequence from left to right, but you can also give it as input to the recurrent network from right to left. Okay, so they also used this idea. And they compared their approach with previous statistical machine translation models, and they used this blue score. So this is short for bilingual evaluation under study. So essentially, in the blue score, okay, so it's kind of you want to compute the precision of your translation with respect to some reference translations. So for each sentence, let's say in a source language, you can have different translations. So of course, two people can translate the same sentence in different ways, and both translation can be correct. So in this type of evaluation, you want to figure out if you produce a good translation. So for example, one measure you could use is the precision with respect to the ground truth translations to the reference translations that you have. So assuming that we have this candidate sentence that has only the word the, so the sentence is the and so on, and we have two reference, the cat is on the mat, and reference two, there is a cat on the mat. So these are express the same concept in two different ways. So it can be a translation for a sentence in a different language that express the same same concept. Okay, so if we compute the precision here, so the precision would be the number of words that are appear also in the reference, or one in one of the two references. So the word the appears in both, and this is divided by the number of words that we have in the candidate. So this would be, let's say, a classic approach. In this case, the precision is 100%, so because all the words in the candidate sentence are correct. But actually the sentence has lost completely the semantic meaning, so that doesn't mean anything, although the standard precision is 100%, so it's equal to 1. Okay, so the solution with the blue score is that here we compute, we allow one word to be counted as many times as it appears in one of the reference text documents. So here we have the word the, and the second reference appears once, and in the first reference text it appears twice. So it means that in the candidate translation, the word the can appear only two times, or a maximum of two times. So here we count only 2D as correct, and we eliminate the other 5, so the precision is much lower. Okay, so this solves part of the problem. It's not an ideal solution, so it's not an ideal score, but it's usually the performance of such models are is measured using different metrics. So the blue score is only one of them, so it was used in the original sequence to sequence paper, and they compare with previous baselines, and they show that they can outperform these approaches with sequence to sequence LSTM. Okay, and they show that they also show good results here, and still the model is far from an Oracle rescoring, but it's better than the state of the art. Okay, so they also have some model analysis of the hidden states, and show that sentences and the input sentences that are have similar semantic meaning are close in this embedding space generated by the hidden state vector. So this is an interesting concept. Yeah, these are some the sentences sorted by average word frequency rank and so on. So they show better results than the baseline. And they also in a more recent work, we also have in this work by Cho et al, we also have a problem with a sequence to sequence model, as I said before. So if the documents, or if the, sorry, if the text, if the sentence is very long, the blue score starts to drop dramatically. So the problem is that long sentences cannot be translated so well. So an alternative approach that tries to deal with this problem with long sentences was proposed by Badanow in 2014. So the paper is called Neural Machine Translation by Jointly Learning to Align and Translate. So they are assuming that fixed length representation may be the cause. So actually the representation of the encoder could be a problem here. So they introduce instead of waiting for the encoder to encode all the input sentence into this hidden state, they try to take the all the hidden states from the encoder and use this information, weight it with some weights alpha, and use this information for the sorry for the decoder. Okay, so the assumption that the probability for the producing the current word YE given the previous words and the input X is given by this function. So here the current word that we want to produce is corresponds to this component. The previous word is computed, so the function here, the decoding function, takes the previous word as input. It also takes the cell state, and this memory cell that is computed as a sum of the hidden states of the encoder that are multiplied with some weights alpha that are learned. So here we have fully connected components between every hidden state HJ and every cell state I here. So we have some weight. So the intuition here is, for example, if I don't know, let's say the first or the last word from this sentence is important for producing the first word in this sentence, then we have these weights to that can be learned to model this pattern. And for example, we can assign higher weights to this hidden state when we use C1, and then we can also do vice versa for I don't know CT. We can use higher weights for the cell states H1 or H2 and so on. Okay, so you can model these dependencies through the weights, and this way you can also learn to produce to translate longer sentences. So the weights are log normalized probabilities. So they are based on this equation that gives us weights between 0 and 1. So in this way they act like an attention mechanism. Okay, so yeah, and they show in their paper that they can translate they can provide good translations even for longer sentences using this attention mechanism. Okay, and another interesting paper is the application of this sequence-to-sequence model to for part of speech tagging. So in part of speech tagging, we have a sentence and we want to produce a parsing tree. And the first idea, if you want to use the sequence-to-sequence model, we have to take this tree and transform it into a sequence. So one way to do it is just to traverse the tree, let's say in a depth-first approach, and then You produce the sequence, and then you have, I don't know, the input sentence, and you encode the input sentence, and then as output you will produce the tree. Okay, and they also show good results and improved results over baselines or over previous baselines, including simple LSTM models. And yeah, this is the final slide. Okay, so I have another question here. So how do you actually use the initial translation when decoding the sentence? Can you, yeah, can you, I'm not sure what to which model you are referring to. Yeah, so I'm not sure. Yeah, I cannot see the timestamp of this comment. So are you referring to the LSTM? So the LSTM was on, yeah, the sequence to sequence was on this slide. So okay, the question is, so how do you actually use the initial translation when decoding the sentence? Yeah, I'm not sure if I get the meaning of the question here. If, yeah, if you can ask a question, maybe give me some details on what slide should I go back to, and also maybe try to rephrase it with more words. Anyway, if and also if anyone else has questions about about today's lecture and the presented models, just let me know. Is the last activation used? By activation, you mean hidden state? So, yeah, when you use attention. So, yeah, in the classic model, you wait. So, let me go back to this model. So, you wait until the last hidden state, and to generate the sentence, you use just the last hidden state. Okay, so instead of doing this, imagine that you have these arrows from every hidden state here. So these are fully connected. And you also have some weights alpha on these arrows that you learn during training. So instead of using just the last hidden state, you use all the intermediary hidden states. But you also learn some weights and some relation between, I don't know, hidden state HI from the encoder with respect to hidden state ZE from the decoder, and so on. So it's a more complex model that gives you more flexibility and helps you to use, I don't know, words from the beginning of the sentence in the proper places in the translation. Yeah, so I will give you some details, I think, after mid-November, so I'll have more time about the project. And actually, I think I'm going to propose two projects in the same time. So it's, these will not be one after the other. They'll be proposed in the same time, and you can opt for which one you or either one that you want. Okay, so yeah, for the moment, I'm not sure what extra details to give. I didn't thought of the tasks that you can approach. I have some idea, but I still have to prepare the data for the image task, and I also have to think of the data to be used for the NLP task. So there are going to be two tasks, one for computer vision and one for NLP. So you can participate in either one or in both. You can decide. But I'm definitely going to propose them after 16 November. So, but also before the end of November. Yeah, so we use the same grading policy, so as I explained in the first lecture. But we will exclude from the ranking. So yeah, you will get a single mark. So you can participate only in one project, and you can get your grade based on that participation. If you participate in two, you can get an extra point depending on your ranking. But also, if you choose to, so for example, if you participate in both competitions and you obtain good rankings or similar rankings in both of them, you can get an extra point. But if you have a good ranking in one competition and a bad ranking in the other, you can choose to use the best possible ranking for you. So you will present only one of the projects, the one that gave you the best results. And also, we will remove you from the other ranking so other people can get higher grades. So if you will rank only for one problem. Okay, so this is the typical architecture of RNN with TANH. I'm not sure that maybe you can also use them with RELU. I'm not completely sure about this. And as I said in one slide, there was some proposal to use RELU instead of TANH to be able to achieve more stable training. But the classic, the standard, the LSTM architecture is with TANH. Okay, I don't see any new questions, but I can still wait for a few more minutes. Good question. So when do you need to use? So yeah, you can check out this graph too. So I'm not sure if there is a recommendation, but you can see here if you get I don't know more than 20 words, the score already starts to decrease. And I don't know, by the time you get I don't know 40 words and so on, it's very bad. So yeah, if you use attention, they showed experiments up to 60 sentences, sorry, 60 words per sentence, and you still stay at the same blue score. So yeah, according to these experiments, but it also may depend on the language, I don't know, on the pair of languages. But for these experiments, it seems that I think this is English and Spanish. So after 20 words, I think you need attention. What do you mean you have a smaller sentence than? So the input, so yeah. this model, maybe it wasn't clear, but this is actually, this is unfolded, right? So here we have the input of a single word. So you can unfold the architecture depending on the number of words that you have as input. So you have three words for one input example, you can unfold it three times. If you have, I don't know, 60 words, you unfold it 60 times. So the number of unfolding steps can be proportional to the input. So this is one advantage in using recurrent neural networks, is that the input can have a variable size. So it can have from, I don't know, one words to an infinite number of words. In theory, in practice, you'll have to put some threshold, but it can be large enough to fit, I don't know, sentence of any length. Okay, so you shouldn't think of this as a fixed architecture, but the input and the output are variable in length. Okay, I don't see any more sentences, so any more questions, so I will try to wrap up the presentation. Yes, exactly. So the parameters are only those in the LSTM cell. So these are the same LSTM cell at different moments in time, and here you also have a decoder LSTM cell at different moments in time. But the parameters are only those in that LSTM cell. Okay, so guys, thank you for participation. So next time we will discuss, I think, about autoencoders. If I'm not wrong, exactly. So next time we will discuss about autoencoders, and then we will discuss about generative adversarial networks. So these will be the next two topics for our lectures. And as I said before, after 16 November, I will also propose the competitions for the two projects. So yeah, when I will propose them, I will add links on the website, and I will also present them during for a few minutes during the lecture on YouTube, so that you can participate from the beginning. Okay. Thank you. So, see you next week.